For the invitation, it's really a pleasure to be back in Sicily for the summer school. And so my talk this morning, I hope you can hear me everywhere, yeah? My talk will be about the importance of anatomical and physiological models in image computing, because it has to do with medicine, the scientific contracts we have with the industry. And the talk is in two parts. I will first give a kind of an introduction to medical image computing, emphasizing the role of the anatomy and the physiology. And then, in the second part of the talk, I will show how we can use these models to generate, for instance, additional data with ground truth for machine learning applications. And so I will start with the first part and remind you, of course, that we are dealing here with medical images. For instance, the major ones in the hospitals are the CT scan, the MRI, the PET scan, the ultrasound. And what these images provide is very specific. They provide information on the structure, that is the geometry of the anatomy of the human body, and they provide also information on the function. This is what is called the physiology, the way the organs work. They provide information also on the metabolism, and this information are collected, as you know, in a volume element, in each volume element called a voxel, and the images, because of that, are called 3D images, volumetric images. We see here examples of the extraction of this anatomical information from the images. And in addition to the space dimensions, it's possible to have access also to the temporal information. So images become 4D images. And this is very important if you want to reveal, for instance, the motion of an organ. Here it is heart, beating heart. Bonjour Alison. Bonjour Samir. And it's also very important if you want to reveal an evolution between two time points. In addition to these well-known imaging modalities, there are many more medical imaging modalities. If you inject, for instance, a contrast agent in the body, you can reveal the vessels. This is the angiography, can be done in CT, in MR. For the magnetic resonance imaging, there are a lot of possible acquisition protocols. So diffusion MR, for instance, can reveal fibers in the brain or in the heart. You can use also spectroscopic MR to reveal the chemical components in each voxel. Perfusion MR, for instance, to reveal the active regions in the brain. You can also have access to mechanical properties of the tissues with elastography. elastography, can use MR protocols, ultrasounds. It's also possible to acquire medical images at a microscopic level. And I will come back to confocal endomicroscopy, for instance, but you have also OCT, optical coherence tomography. And then you can create also images of a specific nature, revealing magnetic or electrical activity of organs with magneto or electrography. And this can be done, for instance, for the brain, this can be done for muscles, for the heart, and so on and so forth. You can also have access more and more often to images available on the web in large databases that will concentrate on an organ or disease, and that can be used, for instance, for some clinical studies, or to compare a given case with a previously studied case. And this is the reason, in front of this overflow of information coming from images, there is really the need, and this is the reason, I guess, why we are all there, to use informatics, computational sciences, to help extracting from the images the information which is clinically pertinent, clinically useful, and to process it in a unified framework. And this unified framework, we can see it as what is called the personalized digital patient. And this is what I will summarize in this slide, where you have a set of computational models of the human body. That's a set of software tools that will reproduce the anatomy and the physiology of a certain number of organs or tissues. Of course, the algorithms in these softwares are built on a number of models that will use mathematics, biology, physics, chemistry at various scales. You also have a number of in vivo images of the patient. And by confronting the computational models with the images, you do what is called personalization. That is, you adjust the parameters of the models so that the models fit the observations, fit the images. Once you have personalized computational models of the human body, you can project them back on the images to help the interpretation of the images. And this is computer-aided diagnosis. It's the first stage of computational medicine. You can also use a personalized model to simulate an evolution, and this is computational aided prognosis, a second step of computational medicine. Or you can use a personalized computational model to do the planning, the simulation of an intervention, and even the control of the intervention, and this is computer-aided therapy. And so you have here a global picture of what can be done with computational medical imaging for computational medicine. And for instance, this is what is typically done in a surgery room of the future, like the one in Strasbourg, with Professor Jacques Maresco, where with pre-op images, they build computational models of the patient that can be used for the planning and the simulation of the intervention. So this is for digestive surgery. And then the intervention, which can be robotized, The control is helped with augmented reality tools where preoperative images are projected back on the patient images to make the patient virtually transparent and help the intervention. This is also, for instance, what is done in image-guided surgery at the IHU of Pitié-Salpêtrière in Paris, where, for instance, for deep brain stimulation of Parkinson's patients, an atlas of the deep gray nuclei is superimposed on the MR images of the patient to help the planning of the insertion of the electrode. This is also what's happening, for instance, in Bordeaux, at the IHU of Bordeaux, where images of the heart are combined with electrophysiology measurements to build a virtual model of the organ that can be used for the diagnosis and also for planning the intervention. And last example is again in Strasbourg, a small company built by Stéphane Cotin, a former student of us. It's the InSimo company where they simulate the cataract surgery with tools that not only allow you to reproduce the very delicate motions of the scalpels, but also are equipped with force feedback, and so you really have not only the visual feedback of the intervention, but you also have a haptic feedback, making it very realistic. So this short introduction was there to really convince you that medical image computing is now a very specific field of research with dedicated research programs, journals, industrial actors, books, conferences, summer schools. I'm sure you are at least convinced of this last point. And if we want to compare medical image computing with general image processing, of course they have in common the fact that they try to extract and process image information. In fact, if we look at the accepted papers at MICAI a few years ago and ICCV the same year, here are the typical keywords used in the papers for the two conferences, and we can see that many of them match, for instance, of course, segmentation, of course, registration, but learning also was already there, detection, tracking, shape, sparsity. But what is really different between the two is the nature of the images. In computer vision, we're dealing with projective 2D images, whereas here most of the images are 3D Euclidean. As I said before, the biophysical meaning of intensity is very specific in medical imaging, and we must keep that in mind. And also we have priors on anatomy and physiology, and these two points really have to be kept in mind when dealing with medical images. Very last slide of this short introduction, we can see this field of computational medicine like a virtuous triangle where we have some multidisciplinary academic research where informatics is combined with other sciences. Some of them are listed here. There is a clinical partnership in most of the research, which is absolutely necessary to address useful problems and to validate the proposed solutions. And very often also an industrial partner. This partner is absolutely necessary when you want to transform the software developed during a PhD, for instance, or the prototype developed during a PhD into a product that is going to be used on real patients. And so to illustrate this in the first part of this talk, I've chosen four examples where I will try to show the progression in the modeling. The first two examples will address more computational anatomy problems, where the algorithms will rely more on geometry, statistics, semantics. And then the last two examples will really introduce computational physiology, the functions of the organs, and they will more rely on additional models coming from biology, biophysics, biochemistry. And so let's start with the first example, which is related to the study of Alzheimer's disease. As you know, it's a public health challenge, and the prevalence of this disease is increasing exponentially with the age. I could have put numbers for 85 or 90, but I didn't want to be more silly than it is already. And image analysis can be used to measure the disease progression and also to assess the efficiency of new drugs which are still being thought. And maybe also it could be used to allow an earlier prescription of these drugs. And so there is a brain atrophy, there is a normal brain atrophy when you're getting older, but this brain atrophy gets larger when you have the disease, and it's in specific regions of the brain that there is this acceleration of the atrophy. And so it's possible to ask medical image computing biomarkers to tell us where and when this atrophy becomes important, and also to quantify this atrophy. So we are talking about very subtle measurements, because the normal annual atrophy rate after a certain age is of the order of 0.2 up to 1.7% per year, the volume atrophy of the brain, and it's considered abnormal for figures which are very similar, 2.2 up to 5.9. Well, not very similar, but at least very close. And there are many approaches to try to quantify locally the atrophy. I will just show one example using registration techniques. So for instance, this is a work that was done by Marco Lorenzi during his PhD, involving also Xavier Penec. And if you take two images taken several months or several years apart, you can try to find a very smooth transformation coming from one image to the other one. In this case, it's a diffeomorphism. So the transformation phi that you are looking for minimizes, in this case, global energy, where you have two terms. One term which is a similarity term, so you try to have the transform image as close, as similar as possible to the second one. And there is a regularity term which imposes the transformation to be not too far from the identity and as regular as possible. So this can be implemented in the framework of stationary velocity fields. So it's a way to parameterize a subclass of diffeomorphisms. And then these diffeomorphisms are parameterized by a set of velocity vectors, the blue arrows that you can maybe see on the slide. And with this parameterization, you can do a lot of things. For instance, Marco showed in his PhD that you can do a Helmholtz decomposition. And so you have two components, one that will encode, this is the rotational part, the local volume variation, and one which is the divergence-free component that will encode the isovolumetric structural changes, typically a rotation, for instance, a local rotation. So we're interested by the irrotational component to characterize the atrophy. We know this component can be seen as deriving from a potential P that we can interpret like a local pressure. And the extrema of this value P will characterize the regions where you have an extremum of atrophy or an extremum of expansion. And then it's possible to quantify using, for instance, the well-known flux divergence theorem in any region through a simple scalar integral. You can characterize the apparent loss of matter or apparent expansion in any region. So what Marco showed, and this was published last year in Neuroimage, it's possible to detect the regions where you have an important atrophy and to quantify in each of these regions with very good accuracy the local atrophy. And also, he was able to show that you characterize the patients with the disease with a larger atrophy than, for instance, the one who have only mild cognitive impairments, which can be an early stage of the disease or not, and that also you differentiate these people from controls who don't have the disease. What is also very interesting is that with this parametrization of the diffeomorphisms, it's very easy to compute an average trajectory, an average evolution of the brain. And so, for instance, here with 70 Alzheimer's disease patients, it's possible to put all the stationary velocity fields in the same reference frame and to compute an average evolution. So the evolution was initially computed on 1 year, but it's also possible to extrapolate with the model, for instance, 5 years in past, 5 years in the future, and to get a very plausible evolution of the disease. So this is useful to compare the evolution between two groups, for instance, a group that would receive a drug and another control group with a placebo, for instance. So here it's just between two group of subjects who respond differently to a biological test. And despite the fact that with the naked eye it's impossible to distinguish any evolution, Marco showed that it was possible to actually characterize a very subtle difference between the two trajectories. It's also possible to use this framework to compute, for instance, the average evolution of a normal brain, of the aging brain, and to decompose the evolution of any patient in two components, the normal evolution and an orthogonal abnormal component. And here again, this was published in Neurobiology of Aging. Marco showed that it was possible, looking at the abnormal component of the trajectory, to characterize different populations of subjects. So this first example on neuroimaging was here to show you that if we look only at the anatomy, we can use models dealing mainly with geometry, with statistics, that would help extract information in the image. Some of this information is almost invisible with the naked eye, so it's like the use of a computational microscope, for instance, to analyze the images. In this second example, we'll actually introduce a microscope in the human body, and it's a bit similar to this movie. Some of you know it, Sandy, maybe, it's a fantastic voyage. There was this novel also by Isaac Asimov, written after the movie, and where, in fact, the rescue team was miniaturized, injected into a patient to remove a blood clot into the brain. As there was a fantastic actress in this movie. Some of you remember, I'm sure. So now, this endomicroscopy, this is the product of Monacea Technology. It's a company in Paris, where they allow you to insert a bundle of optical fibers into the operating channel of an endoscope. And as soon as you have the contact with the tissues, you get images with a resolution of 1 micron and as about 12 images per second. So you will see the architecture of the cellular tissues. So this allows you to see, to get very incredible images of the human body. For instance, if you are in the lungs, you can see the alveoli, and you can see them moving, like in the movie, like in the fantastic voyage. If you're on pancreas keys, and this is the image in the middle, top image in the middle, you can see the circulation of the red blood cells in the capillaries, and this is a very good biomarker of the fact that this is a benign cyst of the pancreas. And you can get images of the stomach, the bowel, the bladder. You can, in the esophagus, you can measure the progression of cancer. So this is for Barrett's esophagus. That's a current disease related to reflux. And so you can differentiate, for instance, a normal epithelium from local metaplasia to dysplasia and to cancer. And so medical image computing is important here because, for instance, this is a case where you have new images that must be interpreted, for instance, by the gastroenterologist or by the surgeon. And you can develop a tool called the Smart Atlas in order to help the interpretation of the images. So, for instance, the idea, if you take a new image here, you would like to have in a large database of previously interpreted images, you would like to have similar cases to appear, and these similar images to appear with their interpretation by an expert. And this is like opening a book atlas at the right pages. And this can be done, for instance, using techniques coming from computer vision, where you, for instance, extract a signature of the image. So it's a well-known method of bag of words based on the extraction of sieved measurements in the images. And when you have a given request, you get all the images which have a similar signature in the database. In this case, this is for it's for a polyp in the bowel. All the images, all the similar images are labeled as benign polyp, and this is also the case for the request. And so more generally, we can see the possibility to, as soon as you create a distance between images, you can learn the image manifold. That is, you can project your data in a smaller dimension space, trying to preserve the distance into the images. And here, it's an interesting image example where for colonic polyps, we've used the metric introduced by Barbara André during her PhD to project benign ones, and so the blue ones, and pathological ones, the red ones, and we can discover a structure in the database. For instance, in some regions, you can see that we have only blue. I don't know if you can see, but in this region, we have essentially blue images. In this region, we have red labels. And in between, we have regions where it's ambiguous. And this is related also to the difficulty to interpret the images. And this can be generalized, this notion of smart atlas, to any problem. This, I know, for instance, Daniel Rickert has been working on that for brain images for Alzheimer's patients. This can be done also for cardiac images, 4D images. And for instance, Ian Margetta in his PhD, or Loïc Le Folgoc, they've started working on the problem of how a new image of a patient with a cardiac disease can be related to images of previously studied patients for whom we have the diagnosis, and how we can automatically put the new image in the vicinity of images with a similar shape and similar motion in order to get interesting clinical information. And this will become more and more useful in the future with the development of large databases of medical images. You've heard about the UK Biobank initiative, for instance, where 100,000 people are being imaged and followed, and with a lot of clinical information. And how do we deal with such large databases? Can we create a very large smart atlas where we'll be able to correlate a new person with a previously studied one? Last example for the second part is the work of Nicolas Padua in Strasbourg, where he uses also automatic classification techniques to automatically determine which type of surgery is being performed. This is for minimally invasive digestive surgery. We are not just before lunch, this is why I allow myself to show you these images. And he automatically finds which step or which type of surgery it is. Okay, so this was for the first two examples in computational anatomy. Now we're moving to computational physiology, so we'll have more of the functions of the organ, or more of the pathophysiology. And the first example is related to brain tumors, so it's not a disease as frequent as Alzheimer's disease, fortunately, but it's affecting young adults and even children. And it's possible to reveal the brain tumors with the MRI. And it's important to develop computational models to quantify the past evolution, extrapolate the present infiltration of the tumor, and predict also the future evolution. So there was this model, now 10 years old, developed by Olivier Klaas, where with simple reaction diffusion equation, he was able to model both the infiltration of the tissue. This is with the classical diffusion equation. It's like the heat equation, taking into account the white matter fibers. And also with the reaction part of the equation, modeling the proliferation. Also, this type of model can be coupled with the biomechanics, with the biomechanical model of the brain in order to predict the deformation of the brain related to the progression of the tumor. So these models have been refined during the past years, and now it's possible to model several populations of cells, proliferating cells, quiescent cells, necrotic cells. All of them are governed by partial differential equations. These partial differential equations are coupled together, and they depend also on the local vascularization of the tissues, which can be measured with perfusion imaging. And so with this type of models, it's really possible to simulate very realistic progression of the tumors, the apparition of a necrotic core, for instance, the progression of the edema. And with some simplifications, it's possible to personalize these models from time series of images. And Ender Konukoglu, for instance, showed in his PhD that he was able to predict the progression, so he learned from images taken 7 months apart and was able to predict the evolution 6 months later. Also to predict the invisible infiltration beyond the visible boundary. And this is very interesting for radiotherapy, for instance, because the infiltration is very anisotropic. It depends on the underlying white matter fibers. And for instance, in collaboration with Jan Unkelbar in Boston, we coupled this biophysical model of the evolution of the tumor cells with the radiotherapy model, trying to optimize the efficiency of the radiotherapy. So I don't enter into the details, but with Mathulé, who defended recently his PhD, there is a typical example where we retrospectively showed that, for instance, instead of a standard dosimetry where you apply a maximum dose on the visible part of the tumor with a constant margin of security around the tumor, it was possible with a personalized model to optimize the dose with a more complex pattern. And here we see a difference, for instance, in red, where this protocol could modify, in fact, the quality of life of the patient after the radiotherapy. This idea of combining a biophysical model of the therapy with the biophysical model of the patient and its pathology was also developed in the PhD of Chloé Audigier, where she was modeling the effect of radiofrequency ablation of liver tumors. And she had to take into account the vascular network of the liver, which is pretty complex, in order to model the blood flow, the heat transport, the cellular death above a certain temperature, And she showed on a number of simulations that she could reproduce pretty realistically the actual necrosis of the tissues in the liver. And so there is this tendency to, with biophysical models, to provide, for instance, in this case, the interventional radiologist with not only anatomical, but also simulated physiological information, for instance, in an augmented reality setting. So it's now time before the break, the first break, to show you the very last example in cardiology where we model even more the computational physiology. And this is of course very important in for cardiovascular disease monitoring. And typically what you want to do when you want to develop a computational heart model is you need to model the structure, so the anatomy of the heart. You need to model the electrical activity, electrophysiology. You need to model the mechanical activity, not only the mechanics of the tissues, but also the blood motion, hemodynamics. And of course, you have to personalize each of these stages. So for the structure, it's possible to use anatomical images and also use the knowledge of the cardiac fibers to put them in the model. The cardiac fibers play a very important role. And then for the electrophysiology, we need to model the evolution of an action potential in the cardiac tissues. So this electrophysiology relies also at a macroscopic level on biophysical models which are governed by reaction diffusion equations. So I'm just showing you here one of these models. There are many of them in the literature. It's called the Mitchell-Schaeffer model. It was developed 13 years ago. But this model is very nice because it has a limited number of parameters that you can interpret in terms of unique currents into the cells. And you can play with these parameters to modify and adjust the electrophysiology of the model with the measurements that you can make. So here we see a simulation, for instance, on this model. It takes into account the direction of the cardiac fibers, and you can adjust very accurately the depolarization times, for instance, between the model and the reality, and you can adjust also the action potential duration, which is a very important parameter. So for instance, Jatin Relan in his PhD with King's College and us was able to show the possibility to personalize very accurately this type of model. And then with the personalized model, you can do, you can simulate some electrophysiology measurements, which are usually done through the insertion of a catheter into the heart, which is a pretty scary procedure. Here you can simulate, for instance, the effect of an ectopic focus, an ectopic activation around the scar and predict the apparition of reentry currents that could create arrhythmia and maybe even fibrillation of the heart. And so you can produce induced tachycardia risk map and proposed to the interventional cardiologist ablation targets, for instance. And so this is very, it's a field very in its infancy, but there are already a number of promising results to evaluate the risk of induced tachycardia. So I will come back to that in the second part of the talk with the work of Rocio Cabrera, and also to simulate and guide an ablation therapy. So the third stage after the anatomy and the electrophysiology is to model the mechanics of the heart. And for this mechanics, there are also many models. So we are relying on a model introduced by Michel Sorin to characterize the behavior of the cardiac tissue. So what is important here is that this model takes into account the electrical model that I presented before. And here, these partial differential equations, they recreate the contraction of the fibers triggered by the action potential of the previous model. And so you can now simulate. So the color is related to the electrical activity. And you can see the effect of this electrical activity on the cardiac tissues. And of course, you have to introduce boundary conditions that take into account the physiological stages of the heart. For instance, when the valves are closed, the volume of the ventricles have to remain constant. And that's an important constraint, among others, that allow you to create a very realistic motion of the heart. Not only you retrieve the characteristic wall thickening during the contraction, but you also have this very typical twist motion, this torsion of the heart during the contraction. So because you have a biophysical model, you can look at some physiological variables, both electrical, but also, for instance, volume, pressure. And you have to adjust the parameters of the model so that you reproduce exactly the measurements made on the patient. So Stéphanie Marchessault, during her PhD, she showed that it was possible to calibrate a number of very sensitive parameters directly using an instant transform. So she was able to initialize a number of parameters which are listed here. And also the team of Dominique Chapelle with Radomir, Chabignoc, Philippe Moirot, they showed that it's possible to refine more parameters locally using optimal filtering, for instance, uncentered Kalman filter. And we have the privilege to have Roch Molero with us, who will present a poster, I think, at the end of the afternoon, and who can answer all your questions on calibration. He also showed that it's possible to use a simplified 0D model to initialize the calibration of the 3D model. And he will present his work at Mikai's this year. So it will be a preview of Mikai's this afternoon. And Roch, put his helmet if you have nasty questions. He is protected, of course. So as soon as you have a personalized model, you can visualize the results. So this is just for the press. What is really interesting is the quantification of the parameters. So here we see a heart failure case, and the parameters show you that this is a heart failure. You can predict, for instance, the effect of a pacemaker. So you personalize an asynchronous heart, and then you depending on the position of the leads, you predict the improvement in the cardiac function that will be related to the introduction of a pacemaker. And this type of tools is it's still prototypes in a number of labs. But for some of them, they are really going all the way to clinical product. This is the case, for instance, of the spin-off of Stanford, HeartFlow, where they actually simulate the decrease in the pressure along the coronary arteries. And they use only the geometrical knowledge of the anatomy to make the biophysical simulation using computational fluid dynamics. And they showed that it's possible to avoid a very invasive gesture where you usually measure this pressure through a catheter with a 1% risk of morbidity. You can replace it with a totally virtual procedure using computational fluid dynamics on anatomical model of the patient. Okay, so this concludes the first part, where I hope I convinced you of the importance of taking into account the anatomy and the physiology in the development of medical image computing tools. And can we do more? Can we do more? This will be in part two, in 5 minutes. Okay, so it's now time to introduce the second part of the talk, following part one. There is part two. Please come in. Okay, so what can we do with biophysical models that we didn't do up to now? In fact, we can use the computational models of the organs. We can use the computational models of the organ to go the other way around, that is to simulate images. So now it's no longer in vivo images, it's in silico images, which are simulated with parameterized computational models. And with the simulated images, for which we know the parameters of the computational models, we can try to learn the value of these parameters from some image biomarkers that we extract in the images. And this is the idea of simulation for learning. And as you know, this is a strategy that was developed by Microsoft for the Kinect, where they used a model of a humanoid model, and simulated millions of fake Kinect images to actually learn the pose parameters. This is, for instance, currently used also by a company, a spin-off company created by two former members of our team, where they use this to manipulate, for instance, the images in the OR without contact for sterility, for asepsis reasons. And this is also used, for instance, by Nicolas Padua in Strasbourg to track the physicians in the OR and compute in real time the exposure to radiations in order to set alarms, for instance, during the intervention, both for the physicians and also for the patient. And this is also, for instance, being used. There was this very nice paper by Microsoft Research at MICA in 2014 to track and quantify the motion of patients with multiple sclerosis and provide quantitative measurements to track the progression of the disease. Okay, so during this second part, I will illustrate this idea of simulation for learning with a number of examples. I will first start with examples in the cardiac domain, and this will be the main part of the talk. I will briefly talk about brain lesion extraction and very briefly talk about brain degenerative modeling. So let's start with the creation of synthetic images of the heart And here you have two sequences. One of them is a real image sequence coming from a patient. It's an MR, a cine-MR image of a patient. And the second one is a fake one, which corresponds to the model of an electromechanical model of the heart, like the one I presented at the end of part one. So do you know which one is the real one? Is it top or bottom? So top, you should raise your hand. Bottom? Yeah, oh, very good, it's about the same, so that's exactly what I was expecting. In fact, the real one is here, and the synthetic one is here, and this one follows exactly an electromechanical model. And so you can see in one region, for instance, we see there is a discrepancy between the motion of the model and the real image sequence, whereas there is a good fit for the synthetic one. So how to generate such realistic synthetic sequences with a non-motion? In fact, if we want to simulate the whole physical process of the medical image acquisition, it's very complex. And so the idea is, in fact, to deform a real sequence so that it will correspond to a synthetic motion that we prescribe. So we start with a real sequence. We consider a synthetic motion, and we combine the two to create a new synthetic sequence from the real image sequence. So there is a very important step, which is the registration of all the images of the cardiac sequence with the first one. And this allows to somehow stop the heart, because at some point we apply the inverse transform to all of the images so that they are all put in the reference frame of the first image of the sequence. And when we play the video, here we have the impression of still organ, but with images coming from all the images of the sequence. And for this registration here, we were using the algorithm developed by Tommaso Monsi during his PhD. So let's be a little more specific on how it works. So we have the real sequence here with ultrasound images from end diastole all the way to end systole. We register each image of the sequence with the first image, T0. And then we have the simulation. So we adjust the electromechanical model with the image, the first image of the sequence. So we have now a model which has the geometry of the first image of the sequence, and we apply a certain value of the parameters of the electromechanical model. So we generate for this anatomical model of the heart a certain physiological sequence. So we have a mesh for which we know exactly the motion between first time point and any other time point. And so what we do, we consider the first image of the sequence remains the same. The second image of the sequence, we apply first the transformation to go back to the geometry of the first image, and then the deformation corresponding to the prescribed motion between time zero and time one. And here we have the new image. For the next image in the sequence, we apply exactly the same. So we put this image in the geometry of the first image of the sequence, first time point, and we apply the motion between time zero and second time point, and we have the new image. And we do the same for all of the images here. And so this was the PhD of Aditya Prakosa, and we get the new synthetic sequence. So the trick here for this to work is, in fact, we combine the transformations. We don't apply first an inverse transform and then back a new transformation. We combine the two transformations, which are two diffeomorphisms, and we apply only the result of the two. And because we apply only the combination of the two transformations, the result is usually a small displacement. That's the discrepancy between the simulated motion and the initial motion. And at the same time point, usually, there is only a small difference. And this makes the transformation of the image small, diffeomorphic, and realistic. And so here we see the result. That's again the two sequences I showed before, where we had the initial motion and the new motion, which is now in perfect alignment with the prescribed motion by the physiological model of the heart. This works for any kind of time series of images. So this works also with CT images. So again, we have a real sequence and a synthetic sequence. And again, the real one is the top one, and the synthetic one is here. And you can see the model, which fits well with the data in the second row, which was not the case in the first row. This works with ultrasound images. And again, we had the real sequence on the top and the synthetic sequence in the bottom. So what is very nice with these images is that we have access to parameters which are very difficult to get on a real patient. For instance, we have the electrical activity on the electromechanical model. We have the contractility parameters on the cardiac mesh. And so we can try to do some machine learning. And Aditya, in his PhD, he showed, for instance, that he was able, this was a collaboration with Philips, he was able to predict the depolarization times from the motion of simulated images. And these depolarization times are related to the electrical activity and which triggers the mechanical component of the heart. And so he was able to show first on simulated images that he could try a number of kinematic parameters on the simulated images. So he was looking for each of the regions of the heart. So there are a number of predefined regions, clinically pertinent. He was looking at a number of deformation parameters, in fact, derived from the strain tensor and the time derivatives of this strain tensor. And he showed that on a number of features that he could compute, characterizing the local deformation in the images, some of these features were very discriminant to characterize the depolarization time. And so he used this most discriminant deformation features computed in the images to actually predict the depolarization times, first on simulated images that were not used, of course, in the training stage, and then he transferred this information on real patient images for which he had the ground truth hidden from the software. And he showed that he could retrieve this depolarization time with pretty good accuracy with respect to the ground truth. And so it was, in our team, the first example where we used, in fact, the physiological model of the heart, the simulation of cardiac images, to do machine learning and train a machine learning algorithm to learn a physiological parameter of the heart. And so the take-home message here is that biophysical simulation, in this case with an electromechanical model of the heart, helped to find the best kinematic features related to cardiac depolarization times. And the second take-home message is that it was much easier to train the machine learning algorithm with the simulated images with ground truth than acquiring a large data set of images on real patients, which is always very, very costly. So second example on cardiac images is the detection of abnormal electrophysiology signals from image texture. And this is the work of Rocio Cabrera in our team in collaboration with Bordeaux Hospital. And she tries currently to predict lavas. So lavas in Sicily has nothing to do, of course, with cardiac activity. But here in interventional cardiology, it has a specific meaning. It means local abnormal ventricular activity. Okay, that's something you can get if there is an eruption, of course, but it's not the case here. And the idea is to combine MR, magnetic resonance image analysis, with a biophysical simulation of the electrophysiology and use machine learning, working both on the MR and the biophysical simulation of the electrophysiology. Just to explain the context of this work, when you have a coronary artery which gets narrow, that's called a stenosis, you have a shortage of blood supply to the heart, and you can have a myocardial ischemia and then infarction. And this creates so-called scars in the cardiac tissues, and these scars can modify the electrical activity, and this can create this, for instance, reentry currents that create arrhythmia, tachycardia, fibrillation, and possibly sudden death. So there is an interventional technique called radiofrequency ablation, where with a catheter you ablate targets in the cardiac tissues where you block somehow the electrical activity, and for instance you remove this local abnormal electrical activations. So the signals between normal and abnormal ventricular activities, they can be measured with a special probe where the electrical activity is measured. And for instance, you have in these red boxes, you have abnormal signals compared to what is called a normal signal here. And so these signals have to be characterized as being abnormal, and they have to be localized on the tissue to become a target for the ablation. So what Rocio is doing, she takes the clinical data that I will describe. She does some image processing on the MR to characterize locally the viability of the tissues. And in addition to that, and this is really related to the biophysical modeling, she simulates what should be the signals based on the nature of the MR image. And then she does some machine learning where she tries to find the best features both on the MR signal and on the biophysical modeling of the electrophysiology to characterize the lavas. And then she gets some results that we shall see in a minute. So the data, it's composed of anatomical information coming from the anatomical MR. And there is also the injection of a contrast agent. So it's called delayed enhancement magnetic resonance imaging, DEMRI. And this contrast agent reveals the regions where you have ischemia, where the tissues are abnormal. And the electrophysiology study, she has some ground truth measurements through a catheter that was inserted into the heart of the patients. And so you have examples here of normal and abnormal signals. So abnormal is in red, normal is in blue. So for the biophysical modeling, she uses the Mitchell-Schaeffer model I presented before. And this model is very nice, in fact, to simulate the behavior, the electrical activity of the tissues in normal regions and in ischemic regions. And so Rocio, she found the way to adjust the parameters of the Mitchell-Schaeffer to take into account the regions where there is a very clear scar. For instance, the conductivity is almost zero in these regions, but also how to adjust the parameters in the so-called gray zone, where you have tissues with ischemia which are not yet infarcted, but are no longer normal tissues. So you get values, for instance, of conductivity in between. And she did also a very nice biophysical modeling of what an electrode records at the vicinity of the cardiac tissues. So it's not directly the activation potential average in an area, but you have to model a dipole which is created by the difference of potential between the depolarized tissues and the tissues which are still polarized. And she did this modelization to reproduce exactly the type of recording that gets the clinicians. So typically, we're talking about meshes of about 100,000 tetrahedra, 20,000 nodes. She has information for about 2,400 electrode locations, so this is what she simulates, and the simulation takes about 12 minutes. So here we see the type of signals that are simulated. In blue, this is in locations where you have normal tissues, so this is the type of signals in blue that you get, and in red, it's in regions which are either in the gray zone or in or close to infarcted zones. And this is the type of abnormal signals that you get. So she extracts a number of features on these signals. They are listed here in this frame. Signal range, mean slope, signal energy, number of inflection points, and fractionation index. And in fact, these features are inspired by those which are used clinically to characterize this type of signals and which are associated with atrial fibrillation. Then the question is, can we, using these features, can we separate normal and abnormal signals? And she did a number of statistical tests, both on real signals, so she tried to separate real abnormal and real normal signals, and also on the simulated signals. And when it's green, it means that the feature is discriminative both for real and simulated signals. So she has a number of features that she can keep and being confident that these features will be useful to characterize the abnormal signals, the lavas. Then, on the images, she extracts a number of features, so I don't enter into the details, but some of these features are directly related to the intensity values in the vicinity of the study point, and some of them are texture features, for instance, the 12 aryllic components are added as features on the image feature vector. Then she uses random forest to try to find which measurements on all these features will be useful to separate normal signals from abnormal signals. And she does this initially only on the image features. Then she does this on the simulated electrophysiology computed on the images, and then on both image and signal features. Then she computes the quality of the results using the classical sensitivity, specificity, and accuracy measurements. And here is a typical result on a patient. If she, so we know the ground truth on these patients. If we use only the features, intensity, texture, to predict where we will have an abnormal electrical activity. Here is the result. We have a number of false negatives, which reduce the sensitivity and reduce the accuracy. If she uses from the images the simulation of the electrical activity with the biophysical model, she gets different false positives and false negatives, and she gets an accuracy which is slightly worse. But now, if she uses the complete feature vector using both the image intensity and the biophysical simulation around the scores, she improves, she reduces, in fact, the number of false positives, false negatives. She improves the sensitivity.
And again, producing simulated electrophysiology signals with ground truth is much less costly than producing real patient electrophysiology data with ground truth. It's a procedure which is costly and which is risky also for the patient. So some examples still in the cardiac is the location of an infarct from image motion.
And this is a work that has been done by Nicolas Duchâteau in collaboration with Philippe's people and with Maxime Sermezan. And so the idea here is to predict the localization of the infarct from the motion observed in the images. And here we see that it's possible to detect scars, ischemia, infarcts with contrast agent in the MR images. So it's with delayed enhancement MR. But in some cases, it's a bit invasive to inject a product contrast agent in a patient. So if we could avoid this, this would be nice. And it would be better to use, for instance, only a 3D echocardiography. I'm sure Alison would agree on that. And so what Nicolas did is he used a learning set where he knew everything. So he could create simulated images with the electromechanical model, where he would locally create an infarct, a region with no contractility, and he models, in fact, a transfer function between the map of deformation of this heart and the location of the infarct. And then, so he does that on a learning set with a lot of simulated images, and then he tests on new cases. So I'm not entering into the details. The reference, the paper has just been published this year in TMI. But the idea, there are two main stages. A first stage where there is a mapping in a reduced space. It's like with the smart atlas I presented in part one. It creates a metric between the motion of the heart. And this metric is very simple. It computes three values of the strain in each point of the mesh. And it just computes an L2 norm distance between the strain values at each point of the norm of the mesh, and so two hearts who have the same deformation will have a zero distance, and if it's a different deformation or a deformation in a different node, then the distance will increase. And so it goes to this reduced space using the well-known isomap procedure. And then when there is a new heart, this new heart for which we don't know the ground truth, it's projected in the reduced space, and the nearest neighbors are looked at, and these nearest neighbors have a similar deformation because of the metric he uses, and they have a non-infarct location, and he just, through a multiscale regression, he just somehow interpolate the location of the infarct of these neighbors to predict the location of the infarct of this new heart. So this is illustrated here, where you have in the red in the red area the new heart, which is projected in this reduced space. You have the four neighbors here. These four neighbors have an infarct. And the location of this infarct is extrapolated or interpolated on the new heart. And he also uses, so this is the average infarct that you see here. And there is a covariance everywhere. There is a variabilities that can be used to estimate the uncertainty on the location of the infarct. So he trained first on 500 synthetic cases, 400 for training. He tested for on 500 synthetic cases, 400 for training, 100 for testing. And he was able to fine-tune the parameters of the software. And then he did that on 100 real cases. To evaluate the quality of the machine learning. And so here is a typical result where we have synthetic cases. So these are two out of the 100 he tested. And you can see the ground truth for the infarct you see in red, and the predicted infarct in blue. So there is a slight over estimation, but globally the location is correct. And you're on real data, so one case where you had an infarct, which is well recovered, and one case where there is no infarct, which is also well predicted. It shows nice results with rock analysis, not the same rock as before. And you can see he was able to adjust, in fact, the parameters for the thresholding of the infarct detection level to optimize the accuracy. That is, optimize the sensitivity and the specificity of the method. So he shows very good results. And he has some mistakes. For instance, he shows on the real cases, he had 108 real cases. So for two of the cases, he missed one of the two infarcts presented on these patients. He found one, but not the second one. And the reason is that the database he has is not large enough. So he had no neighbors. He had no cases, previously studied cases, with this type of configuration. And this really shows what you know in machine learning is to have good results, you need to have a large enough database of known cases with ground truth, and it was a perfect illustration of this. So the take-home message for this last cardiac example is that biophysical simulation with an electromechanical model helps to find the transfer function between the measured deformation in the images and the infarcted zones on the heart. The fact that large databases are mandatory for reliable machine learning, but everybody knew that. And again, producing these simulated images with ground truth is much less costly than producing real patient images with ground truth. So let's leave the heart now for the brain, a much more important organ, of course. And we are looking at brain lesions and the way we can use a pathophysiological model, as the one I presented in the first part, to learn, for instance, the lesion cell density from image intensity. So this was the PhD of Ezekiel Jeremia, and he was initially studying multiple sclerosis lesions, and he showed that they can be learned from random forests. So I'm not explaining random forest because I'm sure you had the course yesterday evening about that. And of course you know that among the features that you extract in the images, you have the random forest will select the ones that maximize the information gain at each node. And so the choice of the measures, he was using local measures computed on T2 and T1 weighted MR images, on flare weighted images. He was using also measurements coming from an atlas of the brain with the location of the white matter, so it's a white matter probability, a gray matter probability index. So he used this as local measures. He used also contextual measures, so measures made in, for instance, two locations away from the considered voxel. So the considered voxel is in green, and he was averaging, for instance, the intensity or the anatomical prior in the yellow boxes that you see, and whose size and location were randomly picked around the green area. So local texture, relative anatomical position. He was also using asymmetry measurements. So looking at the mid-sagittal plane, he was comparing the intensity in the symmetric hemisphere, in a symmetric location in the other hemisphere, and measuring the intensity difference at symmetric locations. So he got very good results for the extraction of multiple sclerosis lesions with excellent sensitivity, for instance. And even in some cases, he was able to detect suspicious lesions that were not modeled as ground truth lesions by an expert, but who were afterwards considered as potential lesions. What was interesting was which measures were selected and in which order. And he found, for instance, that asymmetry was not a very discriminative measurement. It was used in only 1% of the random forests, whereas the contextual measurements were used in almost 80% of the cases, and local measurements in about 20%. The reason why asymmetry was not very useful is that some lesions, and in particular the periventricular lesions, are symmetric. And so it was not a test very discriminative to find the lesions. Also, the order of the test, he found that the first test was flare intensity, and the second one was the white matter proximity, and it was interesting to retrieve automatically with the random forest the tests that were used by Souplet few years before to win the Mikai Challenge 2008 on multiple sclerosis lesions. So these tests were found empirically by the PhD student at that time, whereas with the random forest, it was found in a more principled manner. This was then applied to brain tumors, and here it was a joint publication with the team of Antonio Criminisi, with Darko Zikic, and for the brain lesions, again, local measurements in various MR-weighted, differently weighted images, the use of spatial priors for the white matter, the gray matter, measurement of asymmetry again, and contextual measurements. And here we see typical results with the detection of the necrotic core, the proliferating rims, the edema, the parenchyma. And what was interesting is that the statistics were completely different for brain tumors. For instance, asymmetry was playing a very important role because it's very rare to have a symmetric brain tumor. And there was, again, different weights for contextual or local measurements. And so the last step was to try to estimate something which is not accessible on a real patient, the tumoral cell density. When you create a database with ground truth, you have the boundaries of the tumors, but you don't have the tumoral cell density. And so, through a collaboration with Marcel Krastava, Guido Gehrig, we were able to generate a large number of synthetic MRI using the pathophysiological model of brain tumors I presented before in the first part. And using 500 simulated MRIs and a regression forest, where you don't try to estimate a class, but you try to estimate continuous values, that's the density of tumoral cells. Ezekiel was able to show on hundreds of simulated images that he could recover the tumoral cell density, and then he transferred the results to a few images of real patients, for which we didn't have the ground truth, but we have the boundary of the tumors, and by thresholding the tumoral cell density, we could show that there was a good match between the prediction and the reality. So the take-home message, again, is it's possible to simulate MRIs of brain tumors with a pathophysiological model of these tumors, and you can use that to train machine learning algorithms, for instance, to learn local cell densities. Producing these images, I wrote, is much easier by simulation. In fact, I should even write that I don't know how to produce them on real patients, except maybe with biopsies at each point of the brain to learn the tumoral cell densities. And last point is, it's also possible to use patch-based methods to improve the texture of the simulated images, and this is a work that was just published in July by our PhD student Nicolas Cordier. He showed that he could use a graphical model of these typical MR images of brain tumors and use these graphical models to segment the images or simulate images. And so, for the simulation, the results are very realistic. So it's almost time to conclude this part two, and with only three slides, so be courageous, I will talk about our current efforts for producing brain images of patients with Alzheimer's disease. And this is a PhD of Bishesh Kanal, who defended a few weeks ago. In fact, Julia was on the jury, on the committee, and is using a creep deformation model to simulate the loss of matter in brain parenchyma continuously compensated by CSF, cerebrospinal fluid. So he has a number of differential equations that allow to do this simulation, and he has a parameter A, which is a prescribed atrophy. So in each point of the brain, he can prescribe an atrophy and create a brain image that will deform to reproduce the prescribed brain atrophy everywhere, and the ventricles will expand to compensate for this atrophy. So here it's an example, for instance, where he prescribed atrophy in a large number of regions segmented by free surfer, I think. And this is what you see is the result. And in these resulting images, he gets exactly the prescribed atrophy everywhere, plus he has the expansion of the ventricle. So here we see examples of different trajectories he can simulate. And he's putting on the web an open source atrophy simulator that can be used by all of us to train machine learning algorithms to find, for instance, biomarkers of this atrophy. And so the last take-home message is a simulator of brain atrophy images can be used to design, train, and benchmark machine learning algorithms to design these new image biomarkers of brain evolution. And we hope it will be used by the whole community as an open source platform. And this concludes these two parts on medical image computing with biophysical, anatomical, and physiological models, and on simulation for machine learning with these models. And I want to conclude mentioning that all these tools that are being developed in medical image computing and computational medicine are really here to accompany a paradigm change in medicine, which goes more and more from normalized and reactive qualitative medicine towards this more personalized, predictive, preventive, and precision medicine. And this is really for the patient's benefit. So if you want to know more on these topics, I'd like to make some advertisement for a number of lectures that were recorded at the Collège de France. They were recorded either in French or English, but they are all dubbed in both languages. And you have a number of lectures, of courses that I gave. So all of them are available online with the slides. All the slides are available. There were also 18 invited seminars given by prominent people, surgeons like Jacques Maresco, cardiologists like Michel Essager, for instance, many others whose names are listed here. And there were also closing seminars with 10 lectures, closing symposium, including lectures by Michael Brady, Daniel Rickard, Guido Gehrig, Antonio Criminisi, Peter Hunter, Olivier Faugeras, James Enskan, Dave Hawkes, Nasir Navab, and Doreen Comaniciu. So I really invite you to have a look at all these talks. And I want to thank all the members of our team. This is our annual scientific retreat. And I want to thank you for your attention.